good evening to all our viewers. I am Mr. Tavirendra and welcome to our special broadcast on Karnataka elections. Today we focus on social media and fake news, and I'm also joined by my colleague Karthikeya Sharma, who is the political editor of WION. And over the next half an hour, we take you through an issue that could prove to be Facebook's first big test after the data breach scandal and its impact on the Karnataka elections.
Absolutely.
In fact, Facebook is already facing the storm worldwide for data breach and data mining, which came to light during the US presidential elections. Facebook has taken several steps following the scandal to ensure that it should not end up as a platform for those who peddle fake news. As part of this program, Facebook has joined hands with an Indian company called WION to launch a pilot program to curb fake news in the upcoming assembly elections in the South Indian state of Karnataka. Fake news is not new when it comes to Indian elections, as we have seen in the past. From fake posters to rumors, fake news through social media has changed the very dynamic of Indian elections. All one needs to do is to use an anonymous handle to peddle fake news to mar the prospects of a political party or a candidate in the election. The idea is to destroy the reputation or build an impression on non-factual issues to sway public opinion. Today in India, various political parties use Twitter, WhatsApp and Facebook to organize public opinion.
The most important part here is that fake news is not limited to one part of Indian political life. What it does is it challenges the sanctity of the elections. Facebook actually challenges the underpinning of the democracy because it tends to influence the voter. Now, one such example is Rahul Gandhi, the Congress president. His sudden call to organize a midnight rally seeking justice for Kathua and now rape victims. He did it on his Twitter handle. He used his Twitter handle to ask Congress workers to assemble at India Gate. It was not something as if the mails went. It was not something it was publicized on radio, on TV or in newspapers. All he did was a tweet. Secondly, during Gujarat polls, BJP created thousands of WhatsApp groups to organize booth level workers. So you had 500 WhatsApp groups in Surat, you had 300 WhatsApp groups in Ahmedabad. So what were they doing? They were circumventing newspaper, TV, radio. So on social platform, they were connected both to the voter and to the worker. Now, more than posters and hoardings, political parties use social media to reach out to its voters.
That's right. But now in Karnataka, ahead of the elections that are scheduled to be held on the 12th of May, a certified Facebook team will be fact-checking stories by Facebook users. Now, in case a news story is fake, then the Facebook page administrator and user will be informed about it. Now, we have to also consider the level of impact that these stories have, considering that Facebook has nearly 217 million users in India alone. And India is now among the select few countries where Facebook runs a fact-check program. The other countries include Germany, Mexico, Netherlands, Indonesia, France, Italy and the Philippines. Now, the very idea of this program is to reduce the circulation of news rated as false by 80% of the viewers. Now, most importantly, Facebook will show the story as false in its news feed to cut its distribution and ensure that those who are running these fake stories do not monetize on it.
The bottom line is that Facebook is concerned, and that is why Facebook in a statement said, "We are working to give people more control and encouraging them to tell us by giving feedback when they see false news. Recently, we ran PSAs to teach people how to spot false news in order to make more informed decisions, and we will continue our effort to educate people." So that's what Facebook had to say. The company, the Cambridge Analytica, was able to obtain the data of 87 million users. It helped US President Donald Trump's campaign in 2016. The threat of election manipulation in India is very, very real. And our correspondent, Pragya Jha, spoke to Govindaraj Ethairaj, founder of WION, who is running a pilot project with Facebook to tackle fake news in Karnataka elections.
there are things circulating on WhatsApp and other social media platforms, and because they come to you from people known to you, like family, like friends, you actually believe it and sometimes forward it without even checking. So it becomes truth. So as we say, the velocity of at which this circulates, particularly on platforms like WhatsApp, creates the veracity. So that's really how it starts. So broadly, there are two kinds of fake news. There is stuff that is created with deliberate intent, and there is others which may not have been created with deliberate intent to cause damage, but it ends up doing the same either way. Now, a lot of our stuff, at least at this point, is to do with politics and social and communal and so on. And that's really where the Karnataka elections comes in. I think we've seen it in recent previous elections as well, that the amount of information or disinformation actually starts going up by all political parties. Some may be more than the other because they're more proficient at it. So the idea in this particular collaboration with Facebook was that, and when they reached out was about more than 3 months ago, was to seek whether we can dedicate a few more resources than we would otherwise have or otherwise already doing to focus on Karnataka specifically, and to look at information or misinformation that might be generated or might emanate in that period, which is really in the run-up to the elections, mm-hmm. and how to see if we can bust it. So now the busting itself we do in two or three ways. One is we use tools like, because if it's doctored images or fake videos, you know, you try and you check where it, what the original source is, whether things have been fooled around with. The second is plain journalism, is when you actually look at something and you call up someone and say, okay, did you really say this? Is this what you meant? Was this you in this video saying this, or was this you in this context saying this? And call up and double check. So that's in a way traditional journalism rather than anything else. So when we combine the database capability or the technology as well as traditional journalism, that's when you really have what we would call fake news busting and fact checking, more importantly.
And hence, it's probably no surprise that such a mechanism has been put in place by Facebook, really. Also, if we just recall a few months back, even communal violence was incited in Karnataka's Honavar after BJP MP Shobha Karan Laje went on to tweet that one boy who was found dead was murdered because of his religion, and it even resulted in Section 144 being imposed. So, Karthike Sharma, coming to you at this point, certainly this is a mechanism, a system that was long overdue, especially for Indian elections.
Yeah, absolutely. You see, there are a couple of things which are very, very important. You know, last when I spoke to the Election Commissioner of India, he said that, you know, social media cells have been made in Election Commission. They're aware of the fact that this has taken place. They also wanted to know whether it has impacted Indian elections in past or not. But those are superficial inquiries in the sense that, you know, even Mark Zuckerberg was unaware of the fact that his own data got breached. And he admitted in the congressional hearing. So I think we need to make up there. You know, the Karnataka election is important because a lot of Facebook users, I would say substantial numbers, are in India. India is where the market is. It's a 1 billion strong country, and Facebook is not going to expand in America or Europe. Facebook is going to expand in India. Facebook is not expanding in China. China has its own internal program, social media application. It does not allow these applications to work there. So the bottom line here is that this is a good step, but is it enough? Because Facebook is one part of the internet. You have WhatsApp, you have Twitter, you have multiple other platforms by, you know, the fake news can be peddled. So how do we go about it? Facebook is one little step in this big ocean. It's like a drop in the ocean, but at least it's a start. What we really need in India is regulation, data privacy, and an awareness in people that when they go for application, they take away everything. You know, there's a controversy that we will not give our data in Aadhaar. You work your mobile phone, you are giving all your life into it, because your data, your contact, where you have been, your location, it all goes there. So it's a substantial risk. You know, internet, which was supposed to liberate people and their thought, has become a larger, in Orwellian sense, a surveillance regime.
And absolutely, and a few years back, this might not have been even an issue, considering the debate surrounding how many people will it really influence. India's internet penetration is not as much to influence voters to change who they vote for. But today, thanks to the advent of digitization in India, the situation is a lot different. In urban areas, we're seeing internet penetration reaching almost 50% and above.
Absolutely. So internet is going to grow. The smartphones are going to grow. It's not going to disappear. It's like when TV came, radio remained, but the TV became the main dissemination point. So radio was just giving news and radio was forming opinion. Now what is happening is there's a bit of an opinion on TV, but the maximum news and opinion right now is being made on social media because it's on your mobile. You really don't need to be at a TV, beholden to the time decided by someone in the newsroom. You are the master of your own time, and that's what the social media and mobile phone has done. So instrument which was made for talking has recalibrated the way politics is done. So I think it's important that India ensures, any government at center state ensures that our elections don't get subverted.
Absolutely. In fact, of late, a major part of political campaigning is being carried out on social media, given its ease and the convenience at which the parties get to do it. It is a lot cheaper mode as well and has a much greater reach in comparison to your posters and banners. So in such a scenario, fake news can be a big hindrance in the electoral process. Remember recently, a video went viral in Karnataka which showed the Karnataka Chief Minister Siddaramaiah dancing, or so it said. It was later found to be a fake video, and it was found that the man dancing in the video was actually a farmer from Mysuru, and it was a video that had been uploaded in a funny streak, but it was picked up by a few groups that were circulating fake news. Meanwhile, the Congress also showcased a photo of solar panels in Turkey and used the same image, but we'll come back to that. Let's quickly take a look at the video that went viral. Well, another case of fake news being circulated by political parties, the Congress showcased a picture they put it up on social media in which they showed solar panels and said that it was from Pavagada in Karnataka. But a bit of fact-checking showed that the picture actually was from Turkey and from nowhere close to India. Another post that was put up by the Bharatiya Janata Party a few months ago showed pothole-ridden roads as well as garbage-dumped streets, and neither of them came from Bengaluru, but that was not what the BJP claimed. The BJP claimed that both these images reflected the level of governance in the city of Bengaluru. Another picture that was posted by the BJP that came under criticism was of the street with garbage that were taken from Kathmandu that they had posted in their pamphlets as well, and
absolutely,
they circulated.
Yeah.
And those two drew flak. The Congress also posted a picture of Rose Tree Park in the USA and claimed that it was recovered forest land in Karnataka. So it seems like neither of them is are better than the other when it comes to circulating fake news. In fact, just as recently as last week, even before the Congress could come out with its first list of candidates that created quite a bit of murmurs, there was another list that came out before that, which was a fake list that had been circulated. And this list was complete with AICC stamping, with Oscar Fernandez's supposed signature at the end. And it almost seemed genuine and sent the media into a tizzy. The BJP also tweeted a picture of a bad road from Mumbai, claiming it was poorly maintained road in Karnataka. And despite many people pointing out that the picture was a fake one, it continued to circulate from the BJP handle. So neither of them are holier than thou, we can say. Kartikeya Sharma also spoke to act-a-turn politician and head of social media department of the Congress, Divya Spandana, on the issue of fake news. So let's see how she justified it.
Well, it is a serious issue. I mean, we've seen how fake news can elect people like Trump and Narendra Modi. So it is a serious issue. And we're trying to counter that here in Karnataka. Well, the BJP does this in every election going state. We saw that in Gujarat, where the Prime Minister himself very disgracefully made a statement, comment about Manmohan Singh Ji, our former Prime Minister, and how they spread this whisper campaign that Ahmed Patel would be made the Chief Minister and things like that. So we see how much damage that fake news can do for an election. And they did that in UP, they did that in Gujarat, and now they're doing, you know, a lot of that in Karnataka as well.
Are you aware of the initiative which the Facebook has taken with an Indian company in terms of vetting the content and actually labeling certain news which is certified by more than 80% of the readers, the viewers, as fake?
Well, I think that's a commendable effort, but I'm also a bit wary because I know that the people who head Facebook have some political leanings, and they are family members of the who are a part of the RSS and who've also worked on the 2014 campaign for Narendra Modi. So I'm not sure how credible this is, but I've followed Boom Live in the past and I think they're doing quite a good job. So, well, I think it's in the right direction, but how much credibility that Facebook can lend to this is questionable.
campaign highlights then?
Oh yes, so we will still be talking about development, but you have to see the way people consume news today, right? Fake news and gossip travels much faster. So if I'm talking about achievements of the party and how it's benefited the people, the kind of traction it gets is much lesser. So we have to try and find innovative ways of communicating this, you know, to people, and because it's just the way people consume news today.
So that was the ruling party's version of the events. Divya Spandana telling me as to what the Congress thinks about it. Even the opposition party in the state, Bharatiya Janata Party, had its defense for the gaffes on social media. WION spoke to BJP's Karnataka social media cell convener. Listen in.
Many messages like that, as you said, they, as in when some individual receives it, they tend to believe it because it comes from a trusted source. So I send it to my father. He obviously believes it because I am sending it to him. So there were many websites as well in earlier days to check this fact check, but there is lack of awareness in this. Now it's a most welcome move of the Facebook to tie up with such a website and bringing down these fake news. We welcome it. Now Facebook entering officially with a third party channel to fact check. So I think more people will participate in this, and obviously this will crop down the fake news that is being spread.
Okay, and do you have any mechanism as such? Because individual leaders and individual representatives, it's difficult to control what they put up on social media. And at the end of the day, the responsibility comes down to the party as well. So any mechanism that is in place to fact check?
We already have a mechanism in place for the whatever content that goes out from our official channels of the party and of the leaders. We cross-check it with our research team. So they cross-check it with the data that is available. Then they go with starting from your grammatical errors to the fact checks. So do everything and then they'll approve it. So only after the approval it is dispatched on our various platforms. So we already have a mechanism in place.
So that's the view of the politician. You know, that's what politicians say.
Absolutely.
But Nishita, what does an average Bangalore citizen think about such false propaganda, and does it impact their decision on who gets their mandate? Please listen in.
I think that's extremely important, because a platform like Facebook, where everybody has an access, as we can see, I mean, out of 10 posts, I think two of them are fake and some forwards and some share happening. So I think that's very unfair for a public also to receive such kind of unfiltered content as news. So I think that's going to be a very good step. And not only election, I think that's very general, and news is something that should be extremely sacred.
I think it's a good move. In fact, I think a lot of negative, you know, comments and feedbacks happened on Facebook in such a huge platform. Especially for the election purpose, there's a whole lot of rivalism and communalism just brought in the picture. To put down one person or one party or one team, a lot of such things are being done on a lot of pages, and it misleads the people. So I think it's a good move that you can do, but how far it can be controlled, how far it can go forward, it's a question that we all have to look forward.
Well, there you have it. Bengalurians going on to express their opinion as to what they feel about Facebook putting this buffer zone of sorts when it comes to news on social media, particularly the social networking site in question. Kartikeya Sharma, now Facebook is there, and then you have WhatsApp, and then you have Twitter, and then you have so many other platforms. By putting this one mechanism in place, by having Boom Live do the fact check, which is a small team, as the founder himself went on to point out, can we really stop the problem of fake news?
No, actually, it's very, very difficult. See, we have to understand, rumors are an integral part of the Indian social landscape. Now, I'll give you a sociological example. Now, when 1857 took place, the rumor was that the coded messages were being passed in folded chapatis. Mm-hmm. Now, whether it was a fact or whether it represented the societal anxiety, what it did was that every part of the northern India was up against the British. It's just an example I'm trying to give. So people, what they feel, sometimes that anxiety reflects in rumor. Now, but there is a difference between a rumor and a fake news. Fake news is a financially motivated with political intent, is reproduced through internet. Now, what is happening is that fake news is part and parcel of elections these days, because what it does is it immediately finishes your opponent, you know. Instead of doing his canvassing, instead of talking about himself, Nishita, what he ends up doing is he ends up explaining himself. So Facebook distorts the opinion. What Facebook does is it ends the conversation. Facebook creates echo chambers. It's like what happened in America, the Donald Trump. So your people are talking about your view, their people are talking about their view, and media, which was about a conversation, turns out to be a shouting match. And that is really a problem for democracy. Democracy which are wedded to social media, like social media. And why is social media proliferating? Please understand that it is cheap. You don't need to print papers. You don't need to print posters. You don't need to buy time on TV. You need an ID. You need a cheap card. You get free internet by some companies. All you need to do is talk and write and post photos. So the people are the producers, creators and consumer of the news. And that's what the new world is.
Absolutely. And this particular solution, or if we may even call it that, is restricted to only one form of social media, albeit we have to consider that the consumers for Facebook are huge. But it is just one form of social media at the end of the day. And the problem is a lot bigger than we can even begin to understand it at the moment.
Absolutely. How do you make a surveillance of 1 billion people? Mm-hmm. Someone's humor is someone's crime. Mm-hmm. You know, there are people who are behind jail because they mocked a powerful politician. You had cartoonists behind the jail, they mocked someone, a powerful chief minister. But there are people who cross the line of obscenity. As you said, there are some people who push divergent views for religious and regional polarization. Mm-hmm. So there is a very fine line between liberty and responsibility. Mm-hmm. There is a very fine line between what is an opinion and what is corruption of thought in public sphere. You know, this is the responsibility of the civil society. Suppose tomorrow you have draconian laws. The civil society will say that this is subversion of democracy. And if you don't have some regulation, then you will allow democratic, law-abiding citizens to get preyed by people who are paid to peddle fake news. So there is a very fine line. And that is where the paradox of fake news is. What step is enough? And what step crosses the line which is enshrined in our constitution?
Absolutely. And hopefully we've taken the step in the right direction. So this was our special programming from Bengaluru on this day's biggest political development in the poll-bound state of Karnataka.